Good morning, Una Baptist. How are you doing this morning? Great to be able to be with you and worship with you this morning. In a minute or two, you get to hear some great music from Derek and his family. Again, thanks to them. They've just been doing a beautiful job for us this month. Speaking of this month, our plan is that next Sunday, February 7th, we'll be doing this live. Obviously, we'll be recording it again, and if you're unable or just feel uncomfortable about coming, I certainly understand that. But we'll be doing it live at 10:30 on Sunday morning, so you are invited to be here socially distanced and masked. Things have gotten better this month. As you've been watching the news, the COVID cases have come down, and yet, they keep telling us about these variants that are more communicable. So we will just have to continue to monitor what's going on, being very careful, wear your mask, wear it here at church, socially distance, all those kinds of things. But I believe we can get back together again for Sunday morning worship. So next Sunday, you're all invited either to be here or once again to watch this. Now, if you're going to watch this next week, please be in mind, it takes several hours to get this up online, so it will be Sunday afternoon. So instead of the Super Bowl, you could watch my sermon next week. Well, maybe not. You can find it, though. And we'll get it up there as quickly as we can for you to watch. Prayer need this week, good thing. Lisa is home. Lisa Fox is home. She's on oxygen, but slowly improving, so continue to remember her. There are other things. Look at the prayer guide. Make sure that you're praying. And let's get together next week. Looking forward to it. Now, let's do some worshiping with Derek and his family. Wait a second, Larry. I'll interrupt myself. I want to give you an update on Lisa Fox. I recorded my sermon a couple of days ago, so as of today, Lisa is off oxygen, out of quarantine, and improving. So I want to give you that latest update so you don't have any misinformation. Okay? Now, let's get on to some singing, okay?
Good morning, Una family. It's the end of January. Do you feel like it's the end of January? Well, we've missed seeing you all. Looking forward to hopefully being able to get to see everybody. Next week, did I say it's the end of January? So I think we're all ready to get outside and yeah. But anyway, let's worship together. We're going to sing a couple of hymns this week. And let's start off with How Great Thou Art. Y'all ready? Together, when I survey the wondrous cross.
On home. presence far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul.
All right, let's dig into it. You got your Bibles? Let's turn to Acts 27. We're going to cover the entire chapter. It is one of the most dramatic places of description in the Bible, really. It rivals certainly Jonah and his experience in the storm. In fact, it's interesting. I was doing a little research and looking at this. There was an author, and I don't have his name in front of me, but an author from about 100 years ago, so it's been a while back, but he was an expert nautical man, and he did a lot of sailing, and he took all the descriptions that Luke, here in Acts chapter 27, lays out, and he did the actual journey and put it all together, and he said, this is as accurate as it can be. We'll find out out at sea, they were like 14 days while they were away from shore. And he said, as he was calculating, it had to be at least 13 days. So the 14 days is certainly within that possibility. I just think that's very interesting of the accuracy of Scripture, especially as Dr. Luke is giving us the account of this shipwreck of Paul. As we're ending the study of Acts, we'll have one more Sunday, I believe, maybe two, but probably one more Sunday, and we will have completed the entire book of Acts together. And it's been my privilege to be able to share that with you. All right, let's dig into it. What my plan is this morning is to take this chapter kind of in bites all the way through. We're going to read through it. I'll make some comments along the way, and then we will make some application with three questions as we end it this morning. But it's a great chapter, very exciting, a lot of things to learn and get from it. So let's start off, verse 1, chapter 27. Oh, and by the way, if it works, I'm right now taping this, I believe I can do it. I'm going to try to include a map in the video, so you'll be able to kind of follow along with what I'm talking about, because I think it's important for you to get a visual of what is happening here in this chapter as we're reading it. Verse 1. When it was decided that we were to sail to Italy, they handed over Paul and some of the prisoners to a centurion named Julius of the Imperial Regiment. When we had boarded a ship at Adramyttium, we put out to sea, intending to sail to ports along the coast of Asia. Aristarchus, a Macedonian of Thessalonica, was with us. Now, remember what had happened last week. Festus replaced Felix, invited Agrippa, and they heard Paul one more time. Paul said, I want to go to Rome. And as a Roman citizen, Festus said, to Rome you shall go. And at the end of chapter 26, he said, well, Agrippa said, he's really innocent, but since he wanted to go to Caesar, he'll go to Caesar. And so here we are, not long after that, that Paul, along with a number of other prisoners that are being sent to Rome, are ready to go in a boat and head off. Possibly, I read that possibly some of these other prisoners were going to be the slaves that would have been taken to Colosseum and being used to be the lions, feed the lions. It's the beginnings of that. Nero is the Caesar at this time, the leader of Rome, and it's possible that's what was going on. We meet a couple of people. Julius is one. We will see him in this chapter quite often. He's the leader. He's a centurion of the Imperial Regiment, is my translation, or the Augustan Cohort is another translation. This was a highly trained and very important group of soldiers that was answerable only to the emperor. So he carries a lot of weight. And we'll find a little bit about his character in a moment. There's another character we see here. It's implied it is we. Luke, we know, is writing this account of Acts, and he is with Paul at this time. Now, there was a period of time he was probably apart from Paul while he was in prison, but now he is with him once again, and he is on this journey. Interesting speculation might be that Paul, they were allowing Paul to have a doctor to go with him because he was not well, and that's a possibility. He was having some kind of physical problems. And so they allowed Luke to go with him. There's another man, and that is Aristarchus. Aristarchus met Paul on the second mission journey from Thessalonica when he went into Macedonia. You remember that time many weeks ago. And he is so taken by Paul and the Christian message that he becomes his slave. And we know that Paul didn't have a slave, but he voluntarily becomes his servant. And as such, he's allowed to go on this journey with Paul accompanying him. So there we have it. And the plan was, as we'll see in a moment when I show you the map, the plan was to go on Asia's shore. It would have taken them 5 weeks to get to Rome. But kind of like the SS Minnow, you remember Gilligan's Island? That five-week journey turned into a four-month journey when they couldn't follow what their plans were. Let's go on, verse 3. The next day, we put out at Sidon, and Julius treated Paul kindly and allowed him to go to his friends to receive their care. And so we get a little bit of the sense of Julius, this centurion. He is a kindly man, and he treats Paul with great kindness and gentleness. He's not just a prisoner in the eyes of Julius. And we'll see later on, he holds him in fairly high esteem. And I think it's interesting the relationship between Paul and Julius. And I always wonder at the very end of this, what became of Julius? Well, we may talk about that later. Let's continue on. In verse 4, when we had put out to sea from there, we sailed along the northern coast of Cyprus because the winds were against us. After sailing through the open sea of Cilicia and Pamphylia, we reached Myra in Lycia. There the centurion found an Alexandrian ship, Alexandrian being an Egyptian ship, sailing for Italy, and put us on board. Sailing slowly for many days with difficulty, we arrived off Cnidus. Since the wind did not allow us to approach it, we sailed along the south side of Crete to Salmone. With still more difficulty, we sailed along the coast and came to a place called Fair Havens near the city of Lycia. All right. Hopefully now I'll be able to have that picture of the map in front of you. you'll be able to see where they left in, well, it's on this map, it's Caesarea Maritima, that would be Adramyttium, same place. They go to Sidon, and you can see Asia, right? Up there, Cilicia, Pamphylia, Galatia, that's Asia Minor. And the plan was, as you could kind of see, is to go up, follow the ports along Asia, probably over the Aegean Sea to Greece, and then on up into Macedonia, and getting over in the Adriatic Sea into Italy. That was probably the plan. And as they headed off, the plan looked like it would be okay, but as soon as they started, the winds shifted. Now the winds are typical for a time of year, and they had planned on what would have been typical, the wind coming from the northeast. Oh, you can see it from the map. The northeast would push them to the west. That's where they needed to go. But as soon as they go, all of a sudden the winds change from the northeast to the northwest, and they start struggling. Now they're in a smaller boat at this time. And so they're really struggling, and they finally make it over to Myra in Lycia, and that's where Julius says, I'm getting a bigger boat. And so he gets a boat probably about 120 feet long, a grain boat from Egypt. That was the place where Egypt really fed much of the Roman Empire, especially Rome. And so they were transporting grain in this large boat. And because Julius is a very important man, he leases the boat probably, and he puts on every one in that smaller boat onto the larger boat, and off they go. And as they go, the winds are strong against them. It says they struggled against the wind. They were tacking back and forth, trying to get to where they were. In fact, they went to Cnidus. They couldn't even get to the port. They couldn't get close to the port because the winds were so strong. And so they said, all right, we're going to change our map here. We're going to go a different direction than we had planned. So they head south, and they head south towards Crete. And remember, the winds are coming from the northwest now. And so they say, let's get on the lee side, on the south side of Crete. And so they go to around Salmone, and they finally go to a place called Fair Havens. A nice place. And they said, this is where we'll take a rest here for a little bit, because this has been a rough sail so far. I don't know how we're going to do it. And that's in verse 8. Now, much time had passed, and the voyage was already dangerous, since the Day of Atonement was already over. Paul gave his advice and told them, men, I can see that this voyage is headed towards disaster and heavy loss, not only of the cargo and the ship, but also of our lives. So they get to Fair Havens much later than they had planned on. They're probably already a good 5 weeks into the journey. It says here that the Day of Atonement had passed. What does that mean? Well, you can see it on a map today, or on a calendar rather. Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, is in middle of October, somewhere like that, was what is estimated at this time. What's important about that? Well, as you get into that time period, the Mediterranean Sea becomes very volatile. Winter is beginning to creep in, and anything can happen at this point. So Paul comes. He doesn't use his prophetic voice. He says, listen, guys, I've been on a boat many times. In fact, he's already been in 3 shipwrecks by this time. He is probably as well acquainted with problems on the sea as anybody on that ship. And so he goes to Julius, and he says, guys, I've been here before. I know the time of year that it is. I know what can happen on this sea. I'm telling you, boys, don't do anything. In fact, let's stay put here in Fair Havens. Because if you listen to me, the ship will be lost and we will be lost. Do they listen to the wisdom of Paul? Well, what do you think? Let's go on. Verse 11. But the centurion paid attention to the captain and the owner of the ship rather than to what Paul said. Since the harbor was unsuitable to winter in, the majority, good old democracy, right? Not always the best thing here. The majority decided to set sail from there, hoping somehow to reach Phoenix, a harbor on Crete facing the southwest and northwest, and winter there. All right. You see, they're at least thinking like Paul is thinking. We need to pause. We need to stop. We need to wait until the season has passed, and then we'll take off. But we don't want to winter. We don't want to stay here. We don't want to pause our trip in Fair Havens. Why? Well, most people that I read said the reason is the crew didn't like it. This was not a big port town where there were all kinds of things going on, bars and women and everything else you could imagine. And they said, we don't want to stay several months here. We'll be bored out of our gourds. We're not going to do it. And so the centurion, Julius, says, well, why don't you make the decision? And he says, I tell you what we'll do. We'll go to the end of the island. I maybe throw the map back up there so you can see it. And you'll see where Fair Havens is, and you'll see where Phoenix is at the end of that island. That doesn't sound like a bad deal, does it? We'll just leave here. We'll travel along the coast. It's not that far. And we'll get to Phoenix. We'll be good. We'll winter there. That's a much better place. The boys will be happy. Everything will be good. In fact, in verse 13, it sounds like this was a good idea. When a gentle south wind sprang up, they thought they had achieved their purpose. They weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. But before long, a fierce wind called the Northeaster rushed down from the island. And since the ship was caught and unable to head into the wind, we gave way to it and were driven along. Isn't that just like human nature? This is what I want to do. This is what I want to do. And all of a sudden, you get a couple of nice things happening. See, I knew I'm making the right decision. This is what I want to do, and this is what, and sure enough, guys said, we're not going to stay here in this crummy place called Fair Havens. We want to go to Phoenix. And a nice breeze starts to blow from the south, not the strong northwest breeze. They said, look, this is beautiful. This is terrific. We'll go out here. We'll be able to set our sails, and it will blow us right around to the northwest part of this island. We'll be good to go. They were all smiling, happy, get going. And so they head out. And as they start to head away from Crete, immediately the winds change. Not from the northwest, but a nor'easter. Now, if you've ever watched anything from up in the northeast of our country, off of Massachusetts and that area, when you get a nor'easter, it's a serious storm. And this was a intensely serious storm. So serious that they could not go north at all. It was impossible. It was blowing so hard. The only thing they could do was head in the opposite direction. They couldn't even go to Phoenix. And so they get out and they get going, and it's not good. In fact, in verse 16, after running under the shelter of a little island called Cauda. Let me put the map back up there so you can see it. find where Cauda is. You see it? It's just, you can't, you see the, it actually it's Cauda on the map. You can't even see a dot because it's so tiny, but it's, it, they stop there, and as they're there, they get to the shelter of it so that the wind won't be so harsh on them. Said, we were barely able to get control of the skiff. What they would do back in those days, by the way, is they didn't put the lifeboat, the skiff, it wasn't on board. It trailed behind the ship. And they would use it then if they would just pull it in. But it was so hard, they couldn't even get it in. I mean, this was a crazy storm. After hoisting it up, they used ropes and tackle and girded the ship, fearing that it would run aground on the Syrtis. They lowered the drift anchor, and in this way, they were driven along. Let me show you the map again. And you see where between Crete and Cyrenaica, the African coast, there was a, I don't know if it's difficult to see, it's a little lighter there, but there were huge sandbars, still are today. A very dangerous place for any kind of travel as far as boat travel. And so what was happening, they were being rocked so hard. They actually literally took cable and went around the bottom of the boat and cinched it together to hold the boat together. The weight of the grain and the power of the winds would shift that thing back and forth so much, they were afraid that the boat would, in the middle of the sea, break apart. It was bad. Verse 18, because we were being severely battered by the storm, they began to jettison the cargo the next day. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. And for many days, neither sun nor stars appeared, and the severe storm kept raging. Finally, all hope was fading that we would be saved. You see where they are now. They're in that wavy section out in the middle of nowhere. There is nothing around. And now it's darkness. There's no sun because the clouds are so thick. And of course, at night, it's so dark because of the clouds. Why is that a problem? Well, they have no compass and nothing like that. The only way they were able to see where they were was as they navigated by the sun and the stars. That was it. They didn't even know where they were at this point. And this has been going on day after day after day. 14 days, as we'll see. Verse 21. Since they've been without food for a long time, probably because they were seasick and they were so anxious they hadn't eaten, Paul then stood up among them and said, remember, it saw Paul way back, don't go, guys. Let's stay here in Fair Havens. He hasn't said anything for weeks. Now he stands up, and here's what he says. You men should have followed my advice not to sail from Crete and sustain this damage and loss. Now I urge you to take courage, because there will be no loss of any of your lives, but only of the ship. What are you doing, Paul? Well, the first reading, you say, Paul is saying, I told you so. But that's not what he's saying. I don't really think that's what he's saying. What he is saying is, I gave you wisdom. You didn't listen to it. I'm going to give you wisdom again. You would be wise to listen to it this time. And the wisdom is, at least as we just see it here, the very first part, he says, listen, I'm telling you, this is what's going to happen. We're going to lose our ship, but we're all going to survive. Verse 23. Why do you say this, Paul? All right. For last night, an angel of the God I belong to and serve stood by me and said, don't be afraid, Paul. It is necessary for you to appear before Caesar. And indeed, God has graciously given you all those who are sailing with you. So take courage, men, because I believe God, that it will be just the way it was told to me. But we have to run aground on some island. What's Paul doing? Well, we see some of the things that Paul was doing, I think it's evident that Paul's been praying. And I think Paul's been gracious. You know what? Sometimes when people don't want to listen to us and just simply brush us off, and we find that we're not important to them, we react much the same way. We say, well, fine, to you, I'll go my way, forget you, but not Paul. I think Paul was praying for these men. You know why I know that? The angel of the Lord, in a very strong testimony, says, the angel of the Lord, to whom I belong, covenant language, I belong to God and God belongs to me. I'm in the family of God. The angel of God, whom I belong to, stood next to me and said, Paul, you know I've already told you, God has told you, you are going to Rome. But graciously, God has granted that all these men will be saved. You know what Paul was doing? He was praying not only for himself, but he was praying for all these pagans on board to survive as well. It's a pretty good lesson right there. Pretty good lesson for us. When he's a prisoner, he's not been listened to, but he says, I'm going to pray for these folks. All right, well, let's see what happens. I wonder what the reaction of the men might be. This time, I think they're saying, you know, maybe Paul has something here. Well, let's go on. Verse 27, when the 14th night came, 2 weeks of darkness, we were drifting in the Adriatic Sea. Adriatic Sea, by the way, is that you see it on the map. I'll bring up the map again so you can see it. Between Italy and Macedonia and going straight down. In first century, they called that part of the Mediterranean Sea the Adriatic Sea. So you see where they are, right in about the middle and moving in that wavy line. All right. About midnight, the sailors thought they were approaching land. Why did they think that? Because they heard the breakers. It's midnight. It's as dark can be, but they're hearing something's going on. We're close to land. They took soundings and found it to be 120 feet deep. When they had sailed a little further and sounded again, they found it to be 90 feet deep. Then fearing we might run on the rocks, they dropped 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for daylight to come. All right. So they've gone through the wavy line, and now they're getting close to what we will know as Malta. Let me throw the map up again so you see it. They're getting close. They don't know where they are, but we know where they are because we've read ahead, all right? But they're getting close to a place called Malta. All they know is they hear breakers. They hear the strong surf hitting something. It's midnight. They don't know what it is. And so they start to take soundings. That's dropping a weight down off the side of the boat and then measuring how deep when it hits the bottom. They would pull it up and they would say, well, that was 120 feet. All right, we know where we are. And then a little bit later, they put it down again. Oh, it's 90 feet. That means we're getting closer and closer to land. It's midnight. It's dark as dark can be. So they drop 4 anchors, and these pagans begin to pray. Pray for daylight so we can see something. Verse 30, some sailors tried to escape from the ship. They had let down the skiff into the sea, the lifeboat, pretending that they were going to put out anchors from the bow. Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved. Then the soldiers cut the ropes holding the skiff and let it drop away. This is interesting. This is very interesting. Remember what Paul had just said? Previous verses, all you men are going to be saved, right? This is what God has said. All you men are going to be saved. And here are some scoundrel sailors who are saying, we're getting close to land and we are booking it, man. We're getting out of here. We don't care about the rest of you. And Paul gets wind of this somehow. God makes it available to him. And so he goes, he says to Julius, he said, now listen, if these guys leave the boat, these sailors leave the boat, we're not going to survive. That's what he said. If they go, we're going to die. Now, wait a second, Paul. Hey, didn't you just say, God said you're going to survive? And now you're saying if they leave, we won't survive? I think it's a beautiful illustration of divine sovereignty and human responsibility. God wants us to make sure that we depend upon, yes, but also follow his will. And those things work together. He says, without the expertise of these sailors, we're in trouble. And so by this point, Julius is so convinced by the message of Paul, he doesn't even ask the captain. He goes over, cuts the lifeboats, sets it free, and says, you guys get back in here. We're going to do this together, or we're going to all die together. So get in here. Pretty cool. Verse 33. When it was about daylight, Paul urged them to all take food, saying, today is the 14th day that you have been waiting and going without food, having nothing to eat. So I urge you to have some food, for this is for your survival. None of you will lose a hair from your head. Again, I love the divine and the human combined. He says, it's about time, guys. We're going to survive, but in order to survive, you also got to have some food. Why do you have to have some food? 14 days without food. Listen, I can't go 14 hours without food. Are you kidding me? 14 days, these guys would have been weak. They're going to have to swim, many of them. They're going to have to fight this surf and find their way on this whatever island that it is. Paul says, eat. And I love what he does there. In verse 35, look at it. After he said these things, he had taken some bread. He gave thanks to God in the presence of all of them. And after he broke it, he began to eat. And they were all encouraged and took food themselves. In all, there were 276 of us, this is Luke speaking, on the boat. And when they had eaten enough, they began to lighten the ship by throwing the grain overboard into the sea. Remember, he said, the boat will be lost, all its contents, but not you. And so they say, we're not saving anything. We're getting rid of everything. I love the witness of Paul. Paul had been consistently there with a message of salvation. He hadn't been in their face. He hadn't been putting them down. He hadn't been egotistical. But instead he said, guys, I am with you. Remember, Paul has gone through every problem with these guys. Every storm, every loss of appetite, every seasickness. Paul has been a part of it. He hasn't been spared this. He's been part of it, but now he shows his faith. And when he shows his faith, they are listening. And when he breaks bread, he doesn't just say, eat, guys, but he says, guys, let's thank God for what he's going to do. Man, is that powerful? In the midst of the storm, he is saying, God, we are thanking you for you. When they ate, it says they were encouraged. Let's finish this, or come close. When daylight came, they did not recognize the land beside the bay with a beach. They didn't know what it was. In fact, as you look, Malta, I'll put the map back up there, tiny little speck in the ocean. This is Malta. They didn't even know what it was. After cutting loose the anchors, they finally said, we got to get to this place. They cut loose the anchors, and they left them in the sea, at the same time loosening the ropes that had held the rudders. Then they hoisted the foresails to the wind and headed for the beach. They're going to beach this thing. But they struck a sandbar and ran the ship aground. The bow jammed fast and remained immovable, and while the stern began to break up by the pounding of the waves. Man, they said, we're going to beach this thing. We're going to get this thing as close to shore as we can. Verse 42. One more problem. The soldiers plan was to kill the prisoners so that no one could swim away and escape. But the centurion, Julius, kept them from carrying out the plan because he wanted to save Paul. And so he ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to follow, some on planks, some on debris from the ship. In this way, everyone safely reached the shore. You see, a Roman guard, if a prisoner escaped, he was going to take their place and die. Remember the Philippian jailer? He's ready to fall on his sword when the jail's open, the doors open to the jail, because he knows he's as good as a dead man. That's the same thing here. And so the Roman soldiers were going to kill them because they didn't want to get in trouble, but good old Julius, who has been greatly touched by God through Paul and his message and his character, his integrity, his faithfulness, he says, no way. I'm not going to have Paul going, and I'm not going to let anybody go, because if Paul says nobody's dying, then nobody's dying. That's exactly what he does. I love it. It's beautiful. As this is why I think Julius, part of that Roman guard, you know that Christianity takes off in an incredible way in Rome. I wonder how many would have been affected by a new believer by the name of Julius. We don't know if he was, but I can't believe that he was not touched ultimately by the power of the gospel. All right, let's bring it down with three questions. First question, why does God allow storms? Now think about it. Paul had been told several years before this that he was going to go to Rome, and Paul was ready to go to Rome. He even spent over 2 years in jail in a house arrest because he was waiting on a trial, and he said, I'm going to Rome. And God said, you're going to go to Rome. You're going to be a witness to my Romans. It's going to happen. Well, then why bring a storm? I mean, wasn't he following God's will? Does it ever happen to you that you are doing what you know God wants you to do, and yet there are storms that happen in your life? Health storms, relationship storms, finance storms, things that are unexpected and blowing really hard against you. You know what I'm talking about, don't you? Why does God allow storms? Well, let me just be real profound. I don't know. I don't know. We cannot quantify the reasons of the storms in our life every time easily and simply. It just isn't that way. It's much more complex than that. It's easy to say, well, Satan was the one who was blowing against that boat because he didn't want Paul to get to Rome. Well, that, yeah, I understand that. And who knows? But I got to tell you this. God was not fighting Satan out on the Mediterranean Sea in that boat. There's never a fight with God. God is always more powerful. A word can fell him, is what Martin Luther said, can fell Satan. There is no way that Satan's ever going to put up a fight against God. If God didn't allow that to happen, it wouldn't have happened. Got to think about some of the people in Scripture. I think, and you've already thought of it, I'm sure, Job. Remember Job? Satan comes to God and says, I believe you've blessed Job too much, and he loves you because of what you provide for him, and I think he'll turn his back on you. And so God allows him to do unspeakable things. You talk about a storm, that storm just went on and on and on. And Job's going, hey, what's going on here? Why are you doing this, God? This isn't right. Why are you allowing this storm in my life? Do you realize that nowhere in Job that God explains himself? Never gives him a reason. Never tells him why. He just simply shows up. And for Job, that's sufficient. I think of Joseph. You remember Joseph, the favorite son of Jacob, and Joseph has the multicolored coat and favored and hated by his brothers, and they sell him into slavery, and it goes on for years. I mean, decades. He's a slave, then he's wrongly treated, and man, it's not good. Till he becomes next in line to the Pharaoh, and in comes his brothers, and they don't know it, needing some food. And you remember, he finally brings them in, tells them the whole story, and at the very end of that story, they stand before Joseph. Joseph says this, "Listen, boys, I know you meant this for evil. You meant it for evil. You were out to get me. You didn't like me. You sold me in slavery. You forgot about me. You lied about me. You meant it for evil. But you know what I have learned? God used all these things for good. You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. He looked at the entire picture and he said, were it not for where I was throughout all of those things, I would not have been the man that I am today, nor would I be in the place that I am today. God meant it for good." Why does God allow storms? I just want you to know, don't spend a lot of your time trying to figure that thing out. I just want you to know, you may never know. It's a hard one, isn't it? That's where we have to suspend judgment at this point and say, God, I don't know, but I know you. Well, second question, why does God allow storms? How is God faithful in storms? In the midst of these 4 months journey, do you think there were sometimes some, if not Paul, maybe Aristarchus or Luke were saying, where in the world is God in the midst of this? How is he going to be faithful? Do you know how we learn faithfulness? We do it by doing exactly that. We need to do it by learning. And we learn it from others. Oh, we can look through all of Scripture. I look at Jacob. Remember I talked about Joseph? Talk about his father. If you go back and look at Jacob, he was a rascal and made some horrible decisions. Terrible decisions. And yet guess who is in the line of Jacob? Jesus, Messiah. You see, God takes something that was bad decision. Were there bad decisions made? Absolutely. Just think about it. If they were in Fair Havens and Paul said, guys, we shouldn't do this, and they would have listened to him, we wouldn't have chapter 27. There would have been a 5-week trip after they had wintered there in Fair Havens. But no, they made a terrible decision. When they made a terrible decision, God still faithfully followed through the plan. And the same thing with Jacob. He made terrible decisions, and yet God ended up with the greatest of all things, having the Redeemer, the Messiah, come out of his line. See, we are so easy for us to go kind of one side or the other side, one way or the other way. We're either, it's all God, you know, just trust God and he's going to do it and he's got it already planned out. It doesn't matter what you do anyway. It's all determined and we're just simply passive. Or I'm in charge. I got to do it all. If it's all up to me. No. The way that God does this, you can see it out of Jacob. It is 100% God and 100% us. Is that possible? Well, when I look at Jesus, he's 100% God, and he's 100% man, and I don't understand that, and I don't understand this, but I just want you to know, God is faithful in the storms. Don't be pessimistic. Don't be deterministic. Don't be paralyzed by how I got to make the right decisions or else. But rather, begin to trust that God is faithful in the storms. We learn it from others. We learn it from Scripture too. Romans 8:28, great verse. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. How do we know that? Because we know the totality of Scripture. We know the story of redemption. We know that all things are working together for good. Is it going to be good? Maybe not right now. But we believe that God, you are trustworthy and you are faithful in this storm. It's not God is going to tell us everything and we agree with him. It is faith. God, I may not see the hand of God, but I know that you are there. Well, there's one more question. Why does God allow storms? How is God faithful in storms? And what should you do within the storms? Let me give you three things, and I'll read some scripture and we'll be done. Ready? What should you do within the storms? The first thing you should do is struggle. It's exactly what I mean. You need to struggle in the storm. The struggle is designed to make you stronger on the other side of the storm. James 1:2, consider it a sheer gift, friends. This is from the Message. When tests and challenges come at you from all sides, you know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors. You don't try to get out of any, so don't try to get out of anything prematurely. In other words, struggle. Let it do its work so you become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. You got to struggle through this thing. And the struggle, you become stronger. And the struggle, you begin to see what is weak and strip that away from your life, what is missing and what needs to be added. Struggle. Number two, what do you do within the storms? You need to grow. You need to grow. Listen to this verse. Concerning this, I pleaded with the Lord three times. This is Paul. When he's wanting to be the problems in his life physically taken away from him. Three times I prayed that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is perfected in weakness. Therefore, I most gladly boast all the more in my weaknesses so that Christ's power may reside in me. So I take pleasure in weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. How did Paul know that? He began to know that through the struggle. He learned something and he grew. You don't grow overnight. You just don't grow overnight. It takes a long time. Physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, it takes time. And it's going to take struggles and your willingness to grow through that. You realize that Paul, this is 27 years after his conversion to Christ. After 27 years, he said, I've been in every kind of imaginable circumstance. God's always been faithful. I will trust in him. Grow. Last one is, what do you do in the storm? Well, you struggle and you grow and you trust. God told Paul not to worry. He was going to get him to his destination. Don't worry about it, Paul, the angel said. I'm going to get you to Rome. I will get you to your destination. Listen, folks, I want you to know that too. God has a destination for you, and he is faithful and just, and he'll get you there. Where is that destination? Well, it's not here. It is there. It is to be with him. He is saying, I will do everything it takes, and you can trust me. I will get you to your final destination. This life is not your destination. This is not your final port. It is yet to come. Listen to what Paul writes in 2 Timothy while he's in a Roman jail when he finally made it there. Some of his last words, he said, I'm being poured out like a drink offering. My time for departure is close. I've fought the good fight. I've finished the race. I've kept the faith. There's reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day. And not only to me, but to all those who have loved his appearing. He didn't say, Rome is my final destination. He said, oh, no, 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 no. This is a destination, but the destination is yet to come. And God is faithful and just to take me all the way there. Let me read this to you. So as we look at the story of the shipwreck of Paul, someone wrote, and at the voyage of life, which all of us are taking, we have to say, as many of us have learned to say through the years, everything went wrong, but it all turned out right. I think of the great hymn. Paul could have sang it himself. It is well with my soul. You in a storm today? We all are. sometime. Man, we've been through this COVID storm, still are today. Some of you have had it a lot tougher than others. Some of you will have it a lot tougher than others. The storms that we have, God is there. He is faithful. Let's pray. Father, in the midst of storms, be the Lord of the storm. May we lift our eyes to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for watching. See you next week.